Hello, it's Kelly Tumakoski again. Thank you for watching this final video in our three-part series to prepare for district and school teams to engage in data review. There will be activities again throughout this video to support your active engagement in learning. Please make sure you have about 25 minutes available to watch this video and complete the activities. Let's get started. Please go ahead and set up or access a shared Google document for your team. Pause the video until you're ready to resume. Let's start with the end in mind. What is the result of data review? Recall from the first video in this series that data review is simply what the MiMTSS STA Center calls the protected time set aside for district and school teams to analyze and use data to strengthen their MTSS framework. This protected time might be better described as data-informed action planning or continuous improvement planning. Regardless of what you call it, the end result should be that a team uses data to develop or refine its plan, develops a summary of the plan to communicate to stakeholders, and ensures that the district or the school follows through on the plan. All of this is in order to improve outcomes for students. You'll notice that team is one of the important words highlighted in blue. One person cannot do data review in isolation on behalf of the school or the district. True continuous improvement requires a team of individuals sharing ideas and agreeing to work together towards solutions. Deliverables are what we call the actual products that would be developed during data review. This bulleted list often serves as a helpful checklist for teams to monitor their progress during data review. In this video, we're going to take a closer look at the first four deliverables you see here. Gap statement, or precise problem statement, challenge statement, otherwise known as a hypothesis statement, measurable goals, and updated strategies and activities that you would add to your implementation plan. The first deliverable comes at the end of a team's initial data analysis. The gap statement should be precise and measurable. It should focus on where we are in comparison to where we want to be. It should answer the questions who, when, what, where, and why. And it should focus on the collective, our district, our school, our students. Refining the team's data discovery to this level of precision sets the team up to be able to identify functional solutions. Crafting this statement helps everyone on the team to know exactly what they're talking about. This becomes critical as they move into root cause analysis. Our data review materials use the language gap or problem in the context of a gap statement or a precise problem statement. The precision and ability to measure progress is what's most important, not the language of gap or problem. The term gap, one of the benefits of that term is that it does serve to remind us that there's two parts to the statement, where we are and where we want to be. Possible alternative term is opportunity statement, which you would be welcome to use in replace of gap statement. Here's an example of what a gap statement might look like at the district level. As of fall 2018, two of our three schools that have begun implementing school-wide positive behavioral interventions and supports have not reached the criterion of 70% for fidelity at tier one, with the lowest scores falling within the implementation subscale, and they have average monthly referrals above the national median. As measured by the tier one scores on the TFI from September of 2018, and monthly discipline data in SWIS from September through December of 2018. Here's an example at the school level. Since the beginning of the 2021-2022 school year, our students have received discipline referrals at a higher rate than the national median for every month except October, compared to our goal of all months below the national median, as measured by monthly discipline data in SWIS from September 2021 through January 2022. In this activity, I'm gonna have you review example gap statements on the next two slides. Determine if the gap statement is an example from the district or the school. Share your responses and rationale for your determination with your team in the shared Google document. Heads up, I won't be providing answers in this video, so do please plan to dialogue with your team. Make sure everyone is on the same page and reach out to your implementation specialist as needed with questions. Here's the first gap statement. Was it written by a district team or a school team? Share your response and your rationale in the Google document. Pause the video until you're ready to resume. Here's your second example gap statement. Pause the video until you're ready to resume. The second deliverable is developed as a result of the team engaging in root cause analysis. In MICIP, this product is called a challenge statement. You could also think of it as an if-then hypothesis statement. If we address this contributing factor, then we should expect to see this change in student outcomes. If you've participated in any type of data review or continuous improvement planning before, you're likely to have experienced a situation where the team has only just begun to look at data, but there are already ideas on the table for solutions. Educators are natural problem solvers. We want to get down to business and solve the problems at hand. But here's the thing, not all good ideas are going to give you the results you're looking for. By the time your team gets to conducting a root cause analysis for the gap statement that you identified, it's very likely you may already have a parking lot of ideas on post-it notes. Root cause analysis, when done well, should help you figure out which of those post-it notes to pick up and actually put in your plan. The challenge statement helps your team draw a clear through line from the actual issue that needs to be addressed to the actions that get placed in the plan. Here's an example at the district level. At the district level, the challenge statement should directly connect back to the work of the district implementation team. Specifically, it should focus on building and sustaining the infrastructure to support district-wide implementation of MTSS. That's the district's realm of influence. Your district capacity assessment provides the starting point for root cause analysis. Here's an example. If we strengthen our district's coaching system, then we should expect to see improvements on targeted items from the school-wide PBIS tiered fidelity inventory across our schools. Once a district team understands the underlying root cause, in this case, an ineffective or inefficient coaching system, it now becomes way easier to identify which activities get added to the plan. The focus for planning now hones in specifically on the coaching system. At the school level, the challenge statement should directly connect back to the work of the school leadership team, specifically implementing the behavior and/or reading components of MTSS school-wide. Your tiered fidelity inventories provide the starting point for root cause analysis at the school level. Here's an example. If we address implementation of PBIS in the classroom setting across all of our classrooms, then our rates of discipline referrals in the classroom will decrease. Through root cause analysis, this school team found that ineffective or inconsistent implementation of PBIS in the classroom was at the core of the discipline rates they were seeing. Now they can hone in on activities to add to their plan, specifically around classroom PBIS. In this next activity, you will see some challenge statements. Determine if the challenge statement is an example or a non-example of something a district implementation team might develop. So first, is there an if-then statement? And second, does it address the work of the DIT? Is it within that district implementation team's realm of influence? Share your response and your rationale in your Google Doc. Here's the first example. If we utilize our communication plan and barrier removal process more regularly, then we could support our SLTs in busting barriers that are preventing their work from moving forward. Pause here until you're ready to resume. Here's the second one. We need to reteach behavioral expectations in the common areas after spring break. Pause here until you're ready to resume. Our third deliverable is a measurable goal, or sometimes called a SMART objective. It should be specific, measurable, attainable, relevant, and time-bound. Only the district or the school team itself can make the call if the goal is attainable and relevant to their work, but anyone should be able to look at a goal and determine if it's specific, measurable, and time-bound. The measurable goal is the target for improvement. It's further defining the where we want to be part of the gap statement. Here's a district example measurable goal. And here's a school example. In this activity, I'll give you a few more goals to review. Determine if the goal is specific, measurable, and time-bound. Share your response and your rationale in the Google document. Here's number one. Pause the video until you're ready to resume. And here's the second one. Pause the video until you're ready to resume. The fourth deliverable we address in this video has to do with the actual implementation plan. At the end of data review, the school or district team should have updated activities in their plan. If you're a district team member thinking about strategy selection for MICIP, I'd encourage you to keep your MTSS strategy selection pretty broad so that all or most of your MTSS work across your schools can fold into a single plan. Here are four broad MTSS strategies that are included in the My Strategy Bank for you to select from. You can select multiple strategies to include in your plan and update strategy selection as often as needed. When it comes to adding activities in your plan, there's two types to consider: installation activities and implementation activities. Installation activities are focused on creating the tools and resources needed to support the work. At the district level, installation activities are driven by establishing the infrastructure to support implementation of the MTSS framework with fidelity. At the school level, installation activities are linked to the actual core features of the behavior or reading components of MTSS. Think of installation activities as those behind the scenes activities that typically happen before the school or the district gets too far into actual implementation. Our TA Center keeps track of progress on these activities through those installation checklists in the MiMTSS data system that you're asked to update routinely. Teams may also find it helpful to capture some of those activities in their implementation plan as well, specifically ones they haven't yet completed. Implementation activities come once schools and districts have actually started implementing the components of MTSS. These activities typically get generated as the resulting from data analysis. So they focus on the use of the tools and resources that were developed during installation. For example, at the district level, the district team might, after conducting a district level data review, recognize that they need to revisit their burial removal process to make it easier for schools to use. That would be an implementation activity because they are revisiting something they developed in installation and focusing on its use to make it more efficient and effective. At the school level, implementation activity might be something such as provide ongoing coaching to staff who monitor common areas in the school to make sure students are being acknowledged for demonstrating the school-wide expectations. In installation, there might have been an activity about actually developing the school-wide expectations and teaching it to staff to teach to students, but here in implementation, we're focusing on the ongoing coaching supports to staff. Hopefully those examples help clarify what triggers that implementation activity. What questions do you have thus far regarding data review? Add your questions to the Google document and make sure to follow up with your district coordinator or implementation specialist. Pause the video here until you're ready to resume. In closing, we studied four of the data review deliverables. You can see them in bold here. And we hope that these videos provided you the necessary background knowledge to access your first data reviews, and we wish you luck. Thank you for taking time to enjoy these videos.